collect these things, these experiences, and then they're communicated through our bodies. So the other body that I'd like to talk to you today is about the cinematic body. So the cinematic body would be considered the body of space that the spectators inhabit while they're observing a film. So today, the cinematic body would be the screens, the seats, the projectors, the lights, the whole thing is a cinematic body. So I want you to think about the cinematic body the same way we actually think about the physical body. The Tactile Eye. So there's an amazing book, and if you guys are interested in this at all, The Tactile Eye is an amazing book written by Jennifer Barker. She talks about the cinematic body language. And she says that our body's muscular empathy with the film's body emerges partly from experience. So basically, we may experience the film in a visceral way due to our past experiences. We actually feel the film in our body. So I really began to discover a lot of the similarities between the human body and the cinematic body, finding these connections through movement avenues. For the purpose of this discussion today, the cinematic body will be considered the body of space that we talked about here. And I said, yes, this includes all the cinematographic elements. So more about the cinematic body. So through camera and editing techniques, the video can actually take on a body of its own. So it generates movement similar to human movement. And we understand these movements because of our bodily reference and identification. So basically, what this means is there's some sort of kinesthetic empathy. And what I mean by that is we understand what a person on the screen is going through because we ourselves have felt those similar things. So by this I mean when you see somebody in a film, so we see somebody running in a film, say for example, we know what that feels like because we've experienced that before, right? We've all been running before. Or if somebody on screen is falling in love, we might understand those same feelings within our body because maybe we've fallen in love before. Now, if we see, say for example, a car chase, in a film, we don't necessarily understand what a car chase feels like because maybe we actually haven't been in a car chase, but we still understand what it feels like to have adrenaline and have sudden starts and sudden stops. So that actually can take us in the sort of motion through our body that we'll feel on screen. Does that make sense? Yeah, okay, cool. Just so I'm along with everyone. And also, if you guys want to stop and ask questions as we go along, please feel free. Yes, amazing.
So what if, like, for instance, you say we all evolved, we've all run before. Is it still called bodily empathy or movement empathy?
Kinesthetic empathy.
If you're responding, but it's a negative response, or it's an anti-response. So if you're in a wheelchair and you've never run,
absolutely. Absolutely. It doesn't matter what the response is, but in some way your body's reacting to that. So say, for example, you're in a wheelchair and you actually haven't run before. Your kinesthetic response is, well, I don't actually know what that means, so I'm just going to have to, your kinesthetic response is going to be sort of stale in comparison to somebody that maybe is a marathon runner, say for example. So we all have different levels of it, and the most amazing thing about it is it's completely individual. So when I go see a film, say for example I'm going to see The Avengers or something like that, because I am a dancer, and as you guys can see I'm probably like jumping around here, I move quite a bit. When I go see a film like that, I am all over the place. Like, I cannot sit still because the film is actually moving, and because I have that response and the movement in my body, I move along with it. So, but if somebody doesn't actually have maybe that body identification, they might sit there and have their own specific response to that. So does that answer your question? Cool. Amazing. Yeah, if you guys have any other questions, please feel free. I'd like this to be, we're a small group, so it'd be cool if it's like kind of relaxed and enjoy it. I don't want to bore you. Also, I don't want to bore all the people watching because we're being live streamed right now, which is very exciting. So hello to everybody watching. That's exciting. So so that's essentially what kinesthetic empathy is when we're talking about the cinematic body. So So this quote, this is what really got me excited about this. This is kind of what opened my eyes to the idea of movement in a film. So a lot of people think, oh yeah, Carla, she makes dance films or dance for the camera, when it actually has nothing to do with dance, but it has a lot to do with movement actually in the screen. So this quote right here really brought that home for me. So it says, again, this is Jennifer Barker in The Tactile Eye. She says, when a film swivels with a sudden whip or pan, or moves slowly with a long take or tracking shot, or stretches itself out in a wide screen to take the vast landscape, we feel those movements in our muscles because our bodies have made similar movements. So it's not actually about doing the exact movements, but we feel, we can sense what the movements are in the screen because we've made something similar within our own body. So that to me was amazing, and I totally geeked out over this for months. And so I thought, okay, how can I actually take advantage of this in an artistic way now that I know this information? So I just dove into it head first, and I call this, moving forward, the confidence of ignorance. So basically, because I didn't know anything about film at all, I come from a dance background, that I just said, okay, I'm going to take advantage of this, I'm going to learn as much about this actual subject that I can. So I essentially just took a camera and started filming everything, filming dancers, filming non-dancers, filming people on the tubes, on the street, going to and from work, just everything, just filming everything that I could. And started reading books about body language and about film theory and about choreology, which I'll get into that as well. Doing lots of collaborations, so working with musicians, working with other filmmakers, just of anybody that I could. I just started, do you guys know nofilmschool.com? It's an awesome website, so if anybody's ever wanted to make a film and you have no idea what you're doing, this is a great site. Actually, I also went to Lake FX last week, and did anyone else go to this amazing conference? And I sat and watched a panel of professional filmmakers, and they said, you don't need to go to film school, just go to nofilmschool.com. So I was like, oh, cool, I'm on the right path here. So that was pretty exciting. So basically, the confidence of ignorance. So one thing, if I can give to you guys today, is if you're wanting to do something like this, just go for it, just do it. So that's everything I just said. Cool, so I'm bad at this PowerPoint stuff. Okay, cool, so moving on, editing as choreography. So as a dancer, choreography was something that I studied quite a bit of. I did quite a lot of choreography. And when I started making these films, when I started getting into the editing process, I actually realized that editing and choreography were very similar. I realized this because I started just making these films. Like I said, I didn't really have a way of doing it, but I just started making them. And what I noticed was it actually came quite easy to me. So I did a little research, and I found this amazing film editor, Walter Murch. Does anybody know him? Yeah, exactly. Great guy, super great. And he said one of the key factors to being a great editor is having this innate sense of rhythm. So I was like, oh yeah, I'm a dancer. I have an innate sense of rhythm. Maybe that's why. But it's not only the innate sense of rhythm, but it's really understanding the body. So when I was observing the bodies and observing the movements and then putting that in with the editing, it sort of came really naturally to me. So I was like, this is great. I'm good at this. And then I kind of had to backtrack a little bit to learn a little bit more. But Karen Perlman, around here. Yeah, so I'm not going to read this for you, but Karen Perlman, wonderful. She actually started as a dancer in New York, and then moved out to Australia, and wrote this amazing book it's called Cutting Rhythm. So it's basically an understanding rhythm in film editing. And it came from a dancer, and I was like, oh, this is amazing. So she was one of my major resources throughout this research. So I'll let you guys read that, and I won't waste your time with it, but super amazing woman. So without further ado, I am going to show you this film that I made. It's called The Collectors. So it's basically a documentary-style video experience based on how the body carries a story within our habitual environment. So it seeks to exploit the understanding of nonverbal communication to carry the story through the art of editing. So the movement's goal was developed through the manipulation of the rhythmical structure, surface areas, spatial relationships, and time. The investigation looks deeper into the editing choices in each sequence, focusing on gestural movement connections, as well as the relationships between the screens, quadrants, and surface areas. So I'm going to actually talk about all of those breakdowns after this, about exactly how I made it. Sound in the film was by Maxwell Citron, super cool guy, Stanford grad, Chicago musician and sound artist. Home is his record label, if you guys have heard of him. He's cool, super cool dude. Any questions before we show the film? No? Okay, cool. Awesome. So, I think we've got our guy back there. So this is called the cinematic body, right? As the lights will hopefully dim. Hopefully dim. Cool. Okay, cool. So I'll be back in about 15 minutes.
Thank you.
Thanks so much. Okay, so I am going to press on and talk about some of the sort of methodologies and ideas behind this, behind what I made. So the first thing I want to talk about is something called choreological frameworks. Now, this is something that's really specific to a lot of Laban studies. So choreology is essentially the scholarly study of dance. So he created a language very specific to dance rather than pulling from other art forms. So I was really actually challenged by my colleagues to distill my editing choices. So I was talking a little bit before about, okay, how I was making these. I was just kind of putting these clips together. And so instead of just doing that, they said, okay, distill your choices so you can theoretically articulate what you've been doing. So I decided I was going to make a comparison between choreological frameworks and editing. And I essentially looked to these frameworks because choreology and editing actually are really similar. So choreology and editing. So I found there was an interchangeability between choreological ideas and cinematic editing techniques. So the methods that were utilized that I'll talk about were repetition, modulation of rhythmical structure, proximity, relationships, and interactions. I found the interchangeability between these two, specifically in editing the clips, the screens, the surfaces, and the quadrants, which I hope you guys were able to see throughout the film. So you could actually see the desired bodily expression, relationship, or encounter, so thus allowing the narrative to unfold through these elements. The transitions could be displayed through the juxtaposition of the repetition and stillness, using montage as an opportunity to separate the narratives. So the feeling of the film essentially is derived from the spectator's perception. So it's from your perception. So whatever those interactions were to you, or whatever the encounters were to you, so it's essentially us watching other people. So we all have our own experience with that. So something that means to me might mean something completely different to you guys. Does that make sense? Yeah, okay, cool. Awesome, we're on the same page then. Yes, I've already said that. Okay, so I'm going to talk about some of the ways that I actually put this together. So first is location. I get really excited about this, so if I start jumping around, I'm sorry. Okay, so location. So I place these into location categories. So I did all this documentary film. I did all the filming, and I did two sort of different ways of doing this. I did out in the street scenes, which you guys saw, and then I also did the inquiry in a studio where I focused on gestures. So it was a lot of hands, it was a lot of feet. And so when I had all that footage, I put it into location categories. This was a way for me to actually start distilling the information that I had. So I went back, and when I went back to start editing it, I could actually pull from the categories. So two location categories. The first was locations in space and time. So this would be if you see some of the clips walking away, walking towards, or environmentally, so either in like a town square, or on a train, or maybe time of day, so morning or evening. And then the other location category would be locations on the body. So this would be torso, chest, feet, hands, things like this. And by using these, I was able to bring unrelated clips together. So location categories. I'm going to kind of skip through a lot of this because I don't want to talk too much. Okay, so here's an example, space and time. So these I took specifically from the film. So locations in space and time would be walking, and locations on the body, which would be gestures and hands. So repetition. So one of the things that I talked about before was how we can see and re-see a movement in the body that's fleeting or ephemeral. So I found this to be, the best way to do this is through repetition. So you guys probably saw lots of different clips in the film repeated. I found repetition from a choreological standpoint, it allows us to view and review moments with the repetitive nature, but it also leaves some sort of like residue or lasting memory. But most importantly, when we notice the subtle change in the repetition, that's when it actually draws our attention to that moment or body part. So this actually will demystify the technique and reveal what the creator is trying to express. So if I was going to do this, say for example, I was going to do this in a dance, I might go, I'll just do this. I might go like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, and then 5. Okay, just an example, using repetition. So what I was trying to do was bring attention, actually maybe you guys know, maybe anybody can say what they thought I was trying to bring attention to. Any guesses? Yes. Cool, that's interesting, yeah. Okay, that's super interesting, actually, that's cool. It's a little bit of both, but, so say for example, in like a movement standpoint, if I was looking, say for example, at my foot, then I would be trying to bring attention to my foot. This is just a generic example. So I was trying to bring attention to my foot, and by doing that, I was taking my gaze, and I was looking at my foot, and I was repeating it. Now I did this, say, 4 or 5 times, and then I changed that repetition to, instead of look at the outside of my foot, I look at the inside of my foot, which sort of then reveals what I was trying to show. And then if we talk back about location, which I brought up before, location, my gaze is looking at my foot, so that would give you the idea of the body location. Now, if I was going to do this in a cinematic standpoint, in editing, I would say the camera would be the gaze. So the camera angle, the camera focus would be my face looking at my foot. And then the repetition would be my foot. The location would be my foot. Does that make sense? Yeah? Okay, cool. Awesome. So this is part of repetition. So obviously it was used quite a bit throughout. Now the second one is modulation of repetition. Oh, sorry, I'm so bad at this. Modulation of repetition, which is super exciting to me. I'm just going to put this all up now for you guys. So modulation of repetition, this comes into start talking about rhythmical frameworks. So many of the frameworks manipulated were brought to the forefront by the implementation of multiple screens, as you guys hopefully saw here. So the method allowed the display of repetition and foreshadowing for specific moments. The clips took on a rhythmical sequencing of their own, bringing about movement between the videos themselves as well as in the dual screens. So if repetition occurs for enough times, it draws attention to this specific point on the body or on the screen. Or also, it can take you away from that and you can look at other things, as this lovely lady down here has pointed out. So the thing about repetition as well is you're looking at an object, and if you kind of get exhausted of it, I'm sure you guys felt that. That was the point. That was the goal. You get exhausted beyond into sort of feeling redundant, and then just before you can really actually settle into a specific rhythm, it changes. So one example of this in here, which is probably one of my favorite parts of it, I call this scene "Band of Brothers." And so I was just set up filming on the side of the street, and these guys just happened to walk by, and I caught them. And so the guy in the front would be close to the camera. He had this really rhythmical walk, yeah? So he kind of like had his hands in his pockets, and he slumped into his left foot and then did like a little kick out with his right foot. So he kept this going. So when I went back and looked at the footage, I found this natural rhythm within the footage. So say for example, I'll call the natural rhythm, he walked like 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay, so he walked this way. So when I looked at modulating repetition throughout this, throughout my study or whatever, I looked at 3 different things. I looked at first finding the natural rhythm within the clip. So that was the first thing I looked at. So when I looked through this whole clip, so say for example, this is one long film strip, then you could cut out the part in the middle, which would be his walk, which would be that 4 count that I just said. So his walk was 1, 2, 3, four, okay? So that was his walk. So that was the first thing I did. Then I looked at repetition, which I was just talking about. So not only do we have the four count that he talked about, or that I just talked about, so we have the four count, but now we have the four count repeated, right? These are things like GIFs you guys are seeing all the time on the internet now, like the little tiny four counts just repeated over and over again. I looked at quite a bit of that in the study as well. So that's just being repeated over and over again. Now we could go over this like infinitely. So we have two rhythms going on now. The rhythm within the clip and the rhythm that's being repeated. So I thought, okay, cool, this is awesome. I'm really excited about this. But how can I do it? How can I create another rhythm? So I thought, okay, let's add another screen. And then interplay between the two different screens. So there's a rhythmic interchange between the two. So I'm modulating the repetition between screen A, for example, and screen B. So now we have repetition one of the guy walking four that's being repeated, and then we have one, one, two, two, three, three, four, four. And I was like, oh wow, this is actually like a dance. So I was creating movement between the two screens just like I would create a dance, and I started getting into this rhythm with this. I was like, this is really fun, this is really cool. So not only did the clips have one rhythm within it, but it had a rhythm of repeating, and then it had the modulation of repetition. So that really excited me. So then I went on and started looking at relationships. So relationships within the clips. So this method suggests a relationship between unrelated shots. The technique allows the spectator to be psychologically guided by the visual metaphors. So, relationship categories. Breaking this down a little bit more for you guys. So, first thing I did was by observing the relationships within the clip, which would represent the relationship between people or bodies in space. So that could be, if we're talking back about Band of Brothers, that would be the guys within the clip. So it could be that, or it could be my relationship to you all here in this space, or my relationship to an object in space, something like that. So that could be the first way of looking at a relationship. The second way to look at a relationship could be through the observation of a specific clip, determining its relationship to another clip. So this kind of goes back to when I was talking about location. So how can you put two unrelated clips next to each other that don't necessarily go together? They're not in the same place, they're not in the same time, but by putting them together next to each other, you kind of create this third narrative that then builds without actually saying anything or doing anything, but the clips next to each other build on that. In film theory, they call this montage, but I'm comparing it to dance today, so I'm going to talk about relationships. And then the last way is perspective on relationships is examined by how the clip's positioning in the specific screen can impact the relationship in the surface or formations. So as you saw, sometimes it was the whole, so I call the surface. So it could be the whole surface, and this is talking about the cinematic body, yeah, or it could be one singular clip, or it could be two clips, or it could be three clips. Now if I had one clip to the far right and one clip to the far left, it would create maybe some sort of distance in the relationship. Or if I had them right next to each other, it would create a closer relationship. Now I will say, when I first did this and when I first made this, it was actually on three separate screens. So today I put it up on one surface for you because I didn't have access to three separate screens. But it was also sort of in like a circular format, so it kind of felt a little bit more curved and rounded. So it's a little bit different here today, but still sort of the same idea. So those are relationships. So in this first clip, which I think is really amazing, it attends all three of those relationship categories. So the first one, by the way, this was just randomly filming in the middle of the square. So this was an actual event, not staged, nothing like that. So I'll try and explain this. So the first sequence in the collectors attends to all three of these editing techniques. So the first is observing the relationship between the bodies within the clip. The relationship is emphasized between the little boy and the street performer. And additionally emphasized when the little boy came in with this sort of like startled reverberation. So you kind of came, and I slowed it down so you could really actually see this. He came in with this like curious excitement, and then as soon as he touched the street performer, he kind of reverberated back because he realized that the street performer was actually a real person. So he had this sort of curiosity. which I thought was really interesting. So that would be the first relationship between two people in the actual relationship. Now the second one would be the relationship between clips. So this would be when this clip moved on, you saw the sort of like the shadow effect where the second clip was overlaid over this one, and it was of the man's hand that he was sort of swinging it back and forth, and it gave the impression of sort of like wiping this other clip away. And the reason that I actually placed these two clips together was, if I go back to location, I was talking about location on the body. So in this first clip, you can see the little boy touching the street performer with his hand, and then I did the overlay with the old man's hand, and he just sort of started wiping it away. So when I went and talked about hands in location, that's how I put these two sort of juxtaposing clips together. And then the last one, talking about screens or positioning of screens, was that I decided to make it a full screen rather than a partial screen because I wanted it to be the center of attention. So that is relationships. Cool, this is really exciting. Okay, so proximity. I'll try and get through this quickly so I'm not boring you guys, but any questions so far? No? Cool, okay, cool. So proximity. So proximity as articulated in Dance and the Performative, so proximal behavior articulated in the psychology and sociology of interpersonal science shows how spatial orientation of people to each other carries meaning in culture. So we know this. If you're standing next to somebody, maybe too close to somebody, you feel slightly invaded, something that, an example like that. The proximity of individuals can reveal something about the relationship. So if I'm standing quite close to somebody, that probably means I know them and I'm friends with them. If I'm standing far away from them, I probably don't know them very well. My proximity to you says I'm speaking right now and you guys are listening. So there's another example. So in the actual performative setting, when I did this, the proximity of the camera plays a big role in this. So I was over looking over the person, so it kind of appears that I might be in some sort of position of authority as an adult or something like this. If I was down underneath, it might say that I'm a child looking up to the person, something like that. So that's a little bit about proximity. So basically what the director chooses not to show also in the frame can draw the spectator into the moment. So for example, by expanding the proximal distance between the spectator and the frame, in a long shot, the spectator is intellectually and physically drawn in with inquiry and curiosity. So I sort of did that here by not showing you what Lily was writing. So you can kind of see it. You can kind of see what she's writing, but then the frame changes quickly to a profile, so you can't really see it, and then slowly to the front. So you see that she's still writing, but unfortunately you can't see. So it sort of draws you in with inquiry. You're curious about what she's writing, but we don't really know. So proximal geometry. Another thing. So space speaks, we know this in dance and theater, but so the distance between one another can say something about the type of relationship. So therefore, the distance between the clips in relation to each other. So this, for the purpose of this research, I called it proximal geometry. So the term, it's basically a term I just made up. So most traditional films utilize one screen. However, this investigation uses several screens in conjunction to one another. The narrative can be manipulated purely on editing the screens within the screen surfaces, and the proximal geometry can determine the way that the cinematic experience is felt and seen. So the collectors place high importance on this. Yes, so juxtaposing is a big thing. So basically seeing one screen and seeing what and how can a third narrative be born out of that. So this is another example of that with the man sitting next to the woman here, that they were actually from two completely different shots in two different locations, but the location of the body was similar, the torso up, so I decided to place them together here. It creates a relationship, and there's something really magical about the way this woman is looking, that sometimes I feel like she's actually looking at this man, even though they weren't related. But by placing them next to each other through the geometry of the film, it actually made a connection through it. So, okay, the last one that I'll talk about is quadrant geometry. Yes.
Can you go back to the picture?
Yeah, absolutely.
What made you like want to put both pictures together to create early?
Yeah, so that's a great question. So basically, when I was talking about locations, I said instead of sort of like arbitrarily putting pictures together or putting film clips together, I said, okay, I'm going to separate these into location categories, and I'm going to use a location either in space, so whether it's the space that they're in. So say, for example, this man is on the train, and this woman is out in like a public square. I'm either going to use that, or I'm going to use a place in the body. And so for this specific clip, I use place in the body, and I was still looking at torso. Just torso. So for the other ones, I was looking at hands. But for this one, I was just looking at torso. And then when I came across both of these clips, I found something really magical, that it did actually feel like they were looking at each other, even though they obviously weren't, because they're in two different places. But I found that there's a connection. So based on your personal experience, maybe you make that inference that they might somehow be connected in some way. So that's the basic idea behind that. Yes? What's that, I'm sorry?
Come back to me.
Go ahead. Do you need some time?
This is something that you enjoy, right?
Yeah.
So what is your motivation? Like, why do you go out and take
the
time for it?
Oh, why in general? Because I was making this film, and the whole idea started with looking at body language. So I thought, what better way to look at body language than to look at people in space? Just people going about their everyday life.
So basically, what is your ultimate goal, basically?
To make art.
To show anyone?
Yeah, anybody that wants to see it. Anybody that wants to see it, anybody that wants to listen to me here today talk about it.
Something that I've been questioning, like, what is art? Like, is it your perception of life,
or that's such a big question. What is art?
I've been feeling confused all day because I feel like that question needs to be answered.
I think that's only a question that you can answer. So this is something I'm so passionate about, that I'm so excited about. And it's kind of nerdy, right? Because I'm talking about like quadrant geometry. But when you think about it, it's just so exciting to me that when you actually can see movement in a film, or a film can actually move you physically. But that might be something really different for you. So say, for example, what is it that you're interested in? Yeah. Yeah.
I'm interested in the motive of how did these. I just want to know how your mind connected, put those two images together.
Yeah, well.
That's
what you're interested in, yeah. So my mind put these images together based on the location of the body when I took the film, or when I videoed it.
I think I'm just trying to find like a bigger meaning. I mean, that is a big meaning.
Yeah.
Why you do this? That's what I want.
So observing the imagery that you're working with in the film, and your background in Milan, it's clear I have a background with Milan as well.
Okay, great, cool.
I can make a very strong leap to this with what she's looking at, because Milan is looking at movement through space and geometry within space, and often points into space. Like one of the things is the nine points. So if you think of your body existing in a box around you, and the connection to the dots. Yeah, exactly. Your
Like a sphere. Yeah. Like you're the center of it, and then think about the sphere around you.
So I can definitely see these connections of the dots. Spatial relationship. The movement to the body, to the visual. And then incorporating that, your response to that as a part of it as well, which is the kinesthetic response you're talking about.
Exactly.
It's that whole idea of like, I always, when I talk about it, I explain to people, it's like when someone's speaking to you and they go like this, and then you instinctually just go, even though you may not have anything on your face, they were just doing it.
Yeah.
And that's a kinesthetic response. You're responding to me.
So,
you're you're playing with that a lot.
Yeah, so when you saw the for me, I always pick my nails. That was actually not me in the film. But when you watch that, what feeling does that bring you? It is disturbing, right? Like, even I watch it, and I'm like, that's disgusting. But that's the kinesthetic response you have to that. Some people might feel it's fine, but that's the response that your body is having to that, and it's an actual physical feeling. So that's the basic principle behind that. And thank you so much for saying that. That's really helpful. I know, and this is what I was trying to explain to my dad, and it took a long time to get there, so I know it's going to take a long time to get there. But the basic principles are this. So I'll talk about one more thing here, and then I'll close here. So I'm going to talk about quadrant geometry. So here, I'm going to go back here. So quadrant geometry. So the proximal editing techniques can be broken down even further, looking at the geometry within a shot. So if you think about this screen, this is what I want you guys to think about. Think about this screen and draw a big X down the center. So draw a big X down the center and then across it, vertical and horizontal line. So this whole screen has been four quadrants, yeah? So we can look at top, we can look at bottom, or we can just cut it on top and then bottom, or side to side, however you want to do it. It's totally up to you. And so based on that, how can you see the story in these specific quadrants? Really interesting. Now, if you go see any sort of big motion picture, they do this exact same thing. If you go see, Grand Budapest Hotel, who's... Wes Anderson does this all the time. This is like one of his big things, and he's amazing. But the thing about that is they have this choreographed that's thought out. And so I said, okay, how can I do this with documentary footage? I don't have any control over the factors here. I have no control. But how can I break this down? And I found some really amazing things. So quadrant geometry. So we're going to go back to that very first shot. So when you look at the top shot here, what do you see? You see the location. So you see the location. You can see the buildings. You can see the people. You can see the sunlight. So you know what time of day it is. But then you don't know what else is going on. There's really no context in this at all. No context. But then when you add the bottom half, you all of a sudden get the context. Right? So then that's when you get the little boy and the touch. So without the bottom half of the screen, you have no context. Without the top half of the screen, you actually have no location. So you need both here. The compositional balance and flow of the clips draws the spectator in because of the balance between the clip. So that to me was just exciting. So next time you actually watch a film, look out for this, because it's really exciting. You can see, and it's not just with the top and bottom, it can be right and left, it can be up in the corner and all the way down. So that's actually where the director is drawing your eye to. That's where they're drawing your eye. That's the exciting thing. And now, when you're doing this in a choreographed way, it's even more exciting, because you can really play with it. So, yeah, that's pretty much it, taking this into ensemble work. So, basically how I'm gonna continue doing this, because this is what I'm passionate about, as I said to you guys, and I'm gonna start doing this with an ensemble. So working with dancers or other people to actually put this into maybe into more of a theatrical setting. So I actually did this once before in a film called Beyond the Frames, where I had dancers set up. And it was a choreographed dance in three different video cameras. So essentially when I played it, it looked like they were walking through walls. But that's another story for another day. So that's basically it. The one last thing that I did want to say is something about technology, essentially. It's just such a pleasure to work with film. So if you guys are interested in working with film, it's... opposed to dance or theater or any other like dramatic art, it has the ability to instantaneously displace an image. You have the ability to flip, rotate, repeat, speed up, slow down, manipulate almost every aspect of it, so it's just really, really exciting. In addition to that, I just think it's also really exciting to think that theater and dance has been around, and most other art forms have been around for so long, but film and video is actually one of the youngest art forms, and so if you're interested in any way, it's such an exciting thing to explore because there's so many new avenues, so many different things that you can do with it now, and especially with the technology, you know, there's so many different things, like, you really have to keep up on it, but once you do, it's exciting. So I guess any advice that I have to you guys, if you're interested in doing anything with film, just go for it, give it a try, see if it's for you. So that's basically it. My references, for legal reasons, there's that. Do you guys have any other questions? Yes? Yeah, it is actually. It is online somewhere. Where? it's actually, if you go to my website, carlabachenko.com, it's a film called Beyond the Frames. And it's basically, I filmed it in the same place that it was shown. So it appears that the dancers are actually in the space on the walls, even though they're just being projected there. Kind of in like more of a gallery setting. It's pretty cool. Any other questions? Yes? Yeah, this guy? Not really. But I will say there's so much information out there. It wasn't just nofilmschool.com is amazing. There's just so much information out there. It's almost overwhelming. I did a lot of YouTube tutorials, and it's basically you just kind of like throw yourself in. I would say I was pretty overwhelmed when I first started because I was like, when you look at like I was starting in Premiere, which is on Creative Cloud. So if you guys have Creative Cloud, Premiere is really great. But when you first start looking at it, it's really overwhelming, and you're like, I actually don't know how I'm going to do this. But then when you start playing with it, it's actually really, really easy. You ask a few questions, there's the tutorials, and then you just kind of go. I would just say play with it, have fun with it, make some funny videos. Like I made a whole like film like this to Beyonce's EXO. It was the one that she was, anyways, and it was really funny. I thought it was hilarious, but yes.
So I wanted to ask a question. Where can I see some of do you have any more videos?
Yeah, so this one, because I actually just showed it last weekend. It was like the Chicago premiere at this show called Dance Shelter. So this actually isn't up yet, but you can see my other one, Beyond the Frames, or my other dance choreography on my website, carlabachenko.com.
Film that you want to learn more about.
Yeah.
And like I want to learn how to make it, and I'm just trying to figure out where do I want to get to from that. So what would be your advice for that?
I would just say keep exploring. Are you in school right now?
I'm about to graduate from high school.
You're about to graduate from high school. You're going to go to DePaul for theater arts. Well, okay, well that's amazing. That's so exciting. So I would say my best advice to you is when you're there, when you're at DePaul, take advantage of all the resources they have. Because they're going to have a film department where you can probably go rent a camera and rent a projector and probably a ton of people there that you can go and talk to that will give you all the advice that you need. But take advantage of that and ask lots of questions. Lots of questions. Yes.
So I'm someone who's really good at theater and directing.
Okay, cool.
Have you explored how you can use some of these concepts in live performances?
You know what? That's actually what I'm doing. So this is super awesome. They're doing a live stream right now of this talk. So hey, right? But how cool, I have explored this, how cool would it be? So say for example, we're talking about quadrant geometry, okay? So we've got two screens up there that are pre-recorded of people walking in space. And then the third one is actually a live stream of people walking in space right outside. Pretty cool, right? So I'm actually playing with some of those ideas right now.
Yeah, that makes me very curious.
It's exciting. Cool. Okay, thank you guys so much. Small but strong audience. I really appreciate your time. Thank you so much.